One second, I think please one dot. Page number 43. There are different diagrams of electric lines of force, uniform, non-uniform. There is something called as neutral point N. See on this page, there is something called as neutral point N, which is written over here. See what is written under neutral point. A neutral point is the location where the net electric field due to the charge is zero. We had the same in magnetism also. What is neutral point where there is no magnetic field? The next sentence is very important about the electric charge. It lies near the charge of the smaller magnitude. It lies near the charge of the smaller magnitude because greater magnitude, more field, so it is pushed away. Therefore, write down the side heading, neutral point capital N. What is the definition? It is the point where the net electric field is zero due to the charges. And where it is located, it is always located to the charge of smaller magnitude. Start writing. Page number 43, you will find that sentence of neutral point, capital N. Start writing. Illustration 36, page number 44. Illustration 35 is just a theory question. You can take it as homework. It's just one answer of one theory. Illustration 35, take it as your homework one. Illustration 36. Start reading the question and read the answer as well and tell me if you have understood. There are five diagrams about electric lines of force. You have to identify which of them cannot be possible and why. Okay? And which of them can be possible. So answers are given. Just let me know if you have understood. Okay? Start. Look at diagram A. Is the diagram A correct? Yes or no? If yes, okay. If no, what is the mistake? Similarly, B, C, D, E. Check. I think it is straightforward and it's a common question also because they'll ask to identify which is the wrong diagram or which is the right diagram. They'll give you four diagrams in which you have to find them. Okay. Diagram B is the doubt. Electric lines of force cannot go towards a positive charge. They always start from a positive charge and go towards a negative charge. But if you look at option B or diagram B, can I say electric lines of force are going towards the positive charge? they are going away from one positive charge, but they are going towards another positive charge. So it is wrong. Therefore, diagram B is wrong. Okay, fine. Any other doubt? Diagram E. Okay. In diagram E, they have just given you a confusion. I think if you can see diagram E, in between there is a closed loop. Just check over here. One loop is getting completely closed. Just check diagram E. In between, there are two circles where the loop is getting closed. The entire diagram is just to confuse you. But in between, can you see two closed loops? And you also know that electric lines of force cannot form closed loops. That is why option E cannot be the answer. Understood? So I hope yes. I have clarified option B. I hope I have clarified option E as well. Correct, Mahara. That's all for today, Mahara. Okay, we'll step into half an hour. Long day. You had any other class before mine today?
Sagar, sir.
For that, only one class, right?
Yes.
So this week is also 7:30 to 9, or what is it? No idea.
9:30.
I'll be taking till 9 because I have one more class at 9 for this week. From next week, I'll be taking till 9:30. Today, I'll be taking maximum till 9. I have one more class at 9. Electric flux, see the side heading on page number 45, again called electric flux. Can you check the side heading again? That is called as electric flux. Now, I have told something about electric flux over here. Now, go to the physical meaning. Now, can you see the side heading 18.1 physical meaning? Very important, 2 points. That means the last two sentences of page number 45. The last two sentences of page number 45. What are the last two sentences? The SI unit of electric flux is actually Gauss. But you have to write in terms of Newton also, or you can write in terms of Joule also. Second point, electric flux is a scalar quantity. That means it can be positive also, it can be negative also, or it can be zero also. Actually, in vector also you can do that. But it is just a number. So make a note of these 2 points where you have written electric flux itself. And then we'll go to the Gauss theorem as well. When Gauss theorem starts, we'll come to know one more formula for electric flux. Okay, start writing. What we have to do is we have to write the last 2 points. Page number 45, we have to write the last 2 points. That is point number one and point number two. I'm reading your messages now. 1 minute. Peras, I hope I've answered your question. I'm seeing it.
Yes, sir.
Rahul, I hope I've answered your doubt. Yes. Sakshi, I hope I've answered your doubt. Next page, page number 46. In that, illustration 37. Start. Page number 46. Illustration 37. Start. Then you and I will also start. So what they are saying is the electric field in the region is given by 3 by 5 E naught I cap plus 4 by 5 E naught J cap, where E naught is 2 into 10 power 3, where E naught, the value of E naught is 2 into 10 power 3 Newton per coulomb. Okay. Find the flux through a rectangular surface of area 0.2 meter square. Parallel to the YZ plane. Parallel to the YZ plane means X. Parallel to the YZ plane means X axis means I. Therefore, can I say it is 0.2I? Therefore, can I say in dot product, there is no J, so this will become nothing because J into 0 is 0. Now, 3 by 5 into E naught, which is 2 into 10 power 3. Into 0.2. Tell me what should be the answer with this. Why did I take 2 into 10 power 3? Because E naught is 2 into 10 power 3. E naught is 2 into 10 power 3. Getting the answer 240?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Illustration 38, take it as your homework. Illustration 38, take it as your homework. Illustration 39, start solving. Illustration 39, start solving. Illustration 38, take it as your homework. Illustration 39, start solving. Tell me if you have got the answer. I will also show it on the screen. If you have got the answer, I will also show it on the screen. Illustration 39. Find out the flux of the curved surface of the hemisphere. It is placed in uniform as shown. So can I say the electric field passes only through this? They have given the line. Just check. Therefore, can I say electric field passes through this particular area? Now, this particular area, can I say is pi r square? Because you can check the electric field is passing over here. Therefore, I know the formula for flux is E into A. Now, in this case, it is E into area is pi r square. Therefore, the total flux
so the screen is not visible. Pi r
clear?
Not visible.
Sir, your screen is not shared.
Let me start. Can you see now?
Yes.
So illustration 39 done. Now, next question. Illustration 40. Start. Page number 46. Page number 46. Illustration 40. Okay, let me do the first part. I have written the data. See the data. Consider a uniform electric field E as 3 into 10 power 3 I cap. What is the flux of this field through a square of side 10 centimeters? So look at the screen. Side is 10 centimeters. So if side is 10 centimeters, can I say area is nothing but side into side? Therefore, area is nothing but 10 into 10. Therefore, area is 100 centimeters square. 100 centimeter square is 100 into 10 power minus 4 meter square, which will give me 10 power minus 2 meter square. Therefore, they are asking me parallel to the YZ plane means X, but angle is 0 since it is parallel. Therefore, can I say, see part A, it will be directly E into A itself because there is no angle because it's parallel. Now, E into A. Now, what is E? E is 3 into 10 power 3. And what is A? A is 10 power minus 2. Therefore, answer will be 10 power 3 and 10 power minus 2 will be 10 power 1. So, it will be 3 into 10. So, answer will be 30 in the first case. In the second case, there is an angle of 60 degree. Therefore, can I say it will become EA cos 60? What is the cos 60? Cos 60 value is half. So, half of the first answer was 30. Therefore, can I say answer is 50? This is how you get the answer for B. Tell me, are you getting this answer? All of you got it clear? Easy?
Yes.
Oh, very good.
Yes.
Similar logic. Tell me, can you solve illustration 41? Page number 47. Page number 47. Can you solve illustration 41? Start. Page number 47, illustration 41. I'll tell you the logic. The net flux through the queue will be zero because look at this. In queue, the two sides cancel out each other both ways in all three axes. Here, they cancel out each other. Here, they cancel out each other. X axis, Y axis, Z axis. They cancel out each other. Now, they are showing you step by step. Cos 0, cos 180, cos minus 180. But the overall flux, can I say, will cancel out each other by symmetry. And therefore, if you see the final answer through the queue, you will get 0. Just check. But
yes, sir.
You don't need to show all that in the exam. Here, they have shown you to explain the logic through each phase. Over there also, they have showed in the diagram 1 and 2, the diagram. But if this kind of question comes, you should know through symmetry, the answer has to be 0. But if they ask through each phase or each pair of phases, then either the angle will be 0, 180 or 90. Okay, and you know, cos 0 is maximum, 90 is 0, 180 is minimum because 180 is minus 1. Okay, turn the page. Turn the page. In that, page number 49. Come to page number 49. Come to page number 49. Can you see Gauss law? Side heading. Page number 49. Can you see Gauss law? Everyone? Now, see the last line of that page. See the last line of the page number 49. What is the last line? Mathematically, Gauss law can be written as the total electric flux. Please look at the screen now, okay? He says the total electric flux till now was given by E into closed integration ds, correct? This is the formula of electric flux that we already know. And with this formula, we were solving problems. He said that instead of using this formula, electric flux can also be found out by this formula, total charge enclosed or total charge in the surface, means inside, divided by epsilon naught. What Gauss said, let me repeat, he said that instead of finding electric field and area, instead of doing so much of work, I can get electric flux by a simple formula, total charge enclosed or total charge which is inside, divided by epsilon naught. How this becomes easier, I'll tell you. Can I say epsilon naught is already a known value? You don't need to find out separately. Epsilon naught is already a known value. Therefore, can I say if I know what is the total charge enclosed, I can find out flux also. Over here, I need to know electric field. I need to know the area. I need to integrate. Then I get the electric flux. Instead of that, he said that I can directly use this formula. In other words, if you know the charge, you will know the flux. You know the charge, you will know the flux. I'll tell you the history of this. Before, if radius was not given of a circle, okay, if radius was not given, people could not find out electric flux. Now, can I say with Gauss formula, electric flux is independent of the radius, correct? I just need the charge because previous formula had area. Area had pi r square. But the new formula which Gauss gave, I can even find out electric flux without the radius. Or Gauss proved that electric flux does not depend on the radius. Therefore, if radius doubles and you know the data is given, flux remains a constant. Therefore, what is exactly Gauss theorem is? He said that the total flux inside any object is total charge which is inside divided by epsilon naught. This is the formula for Gauss. But before Gauss gave this formula, which formula were we using? We were using the formula E into integration of ds. Okay, so write down this as Gauss law. This is the formula for Gauss. Okay, write down. That is the last line. Total flux is equal to Q in or Q enclosed divided by epsilon naught. Make a note quick. come to the next page. Q is the total charge enclosed. Now come to the next page. And now it is very, very important. Three paragraphs on page number 50, okay? I'm telling you important because definitely when you get question on Gauss theorem, either of these three points will be used, okay? So we are talking about page number 50, first three paragraphs, okay? Now listen. See the first paragraph. Let me talk to you and let me explain it to you. They are saying, we once again emphasize that electric field appearing in the Gauss law is the resultant electric field due to all the charges. For example, please look at a system. They have given a system in which Q1, Q2, Q3, just listen, Q4 and Q5. I am taking a system where inside the body there are three charges. Outside the body there are two charges. Means totally there are five charges. If I am considering electric field, then all the charges inside plus outside play a role. I will repeat. Gauss theorem, whatever it states, but if I want to find electric field, the charges that are inside plus the charges that are outside, both play an important role in electric field. Means both have to be considered. Okay, see the first statement. When electric field is there in Gauss law, the resultant electric field due to all the charges present inside as well as present outside of the closed surface should be considered for electric field. Now, if I'm considering the charges for Gauss law, the total charge, then only the charges which are inside the surface have to be considered. Understood? So let me repeat the whole first paragraph. Let me tell you in one sentence. If I am considering the electric field is made up of both inside the surface as well as outside the surface. So I have to consider both. But if I am considering charge, the charge which is only inside the surface has to be considered. In simple words, if I want to find electric field of this system, all five charges will have to be considered. But if I want to find the total charge of the system according to Gauss law, only these three charges have to be considered because these two charges are outside. But according to Gauss law, only the charges that are inside have to be considered. Do you understand? So now read the first paragraph and tell me if you can understand. First paragraph. Okay. You have to start from the resultant electric field due to all the charges present inside as well as outside the given closed surface have to be considered. On the other hand, while considering the charges which are only appearing inside have to be considered. That is the closed surface. Okay, so write down that paragraph as a note. Start. The paragraph as a note. Start writing quick. Start. Page 51, illustration 44. Start. Tell me if you have understood the logic for question number 44.
Yes, sir.
Especially the A part. B part will not be as it is only for understanding. Just read it. I want you to tell me whether you are getting the answer for the A part.
Sir, yes, for sir. E naught, can we take 9 into 10 raised to 9
value? For epsilon naught?
Yeah.
1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is 9 into 10 power 9. Epsilon naught is not 9 into 10 power 9. Okay, Sharwari, understood? So you have to take this value on it, okay? Understood, everyone? You have to take epsilon naught as 8.85 into 10 power minus 12 itself. Okay. Come to the next page. Illustration 45. Tell me if you can understand. Page number 52.
Yes, sir. Got it.
Got it, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
You have to write four important formulae. Actually, the derivation is in your 12th, but for a JEE, you will need to know the result. So write down the site heading. It is there on page number 53. Write down electric field outside a sphere. That is page number 53, section 20.4. Electric field outside the sphere. Page number 53, section 20.4. Okay. Now, whenever a sphere problem comes and we need to find what is electric field outside the sphere, so if the point is placed at a distance r, then the formula for electric field will be the same. That is 1 by 4 by epsilon naught into q by r square. Make a note. Where r is the distance of the point from the center of the sphere, right? E is equal to 1 by 4. This is also the formula of general electric field from our few table. Check. E is equal to 1 by 4 by epsilon naught q by r square. Then, next formula is electric field along an infinitely long thin wire. That is on next page, page number 54. Write down. This is electric field along an infinitely long thin wire. And the formula will be E is equal to 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught lambda by r. And I hope everyone knows what is the meaning of lambda. Tell me, what is the meaning of lambda?
Yes, sir.
Linear charge density.
Okay, this is your second formula or your second result. Okay, I'll leave it on this one. Third formula, this is electric field we have already done this in the last class, electric field due to a charged sheet, remember, where we got the formula for electric field. Tell me if you remember this formula, sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Remember, I showed you also where the electric field is for a plane or any paper containing a charge. Sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Again, tell me, what does sigma stand for?
Surface charge density.
Stands for surface charge density. Is it clear? And fourth one, that is the fourth derivation. Actually, we are a fourth formula. Electric field random conductor. Means, what was the first case? Listen to me. What was the first case? Spear. Correct. What was the second case? Wire. What was the third case? Sheet. Now, what if it does not have any particular shape, like a spear or a wire or a sheet? If it has some random shape, then which formula for electric field should I use? Then you have to use the formula electric field is equal to sigma by epsilon naught. This is a general formula for any shape. Do you understand? See the first formula. First formula is specifically for sphere. Second formula is specifically for a line. Third formula is basically for an area. But now what if the diagram does not have any proper shape? It has some random shape. Then the formula for electric field is sigma by epsilon naught. Make a note. Come to page number 60, everyone. Come to page number 60. Now, can you see the side heading? Conductor and its properties for electrostatic condition. Means we have to look at conductors from electrostatic. We have to look at conductors from electrostatic point of view. Now, first listen to me. Look at the first point of the conductor and its properties. Tell me, do you know this point already? Conductors are materials which contain large number of free electrons which can move freely inside the conductor. This is a general definition of a conductor. Fine. So, no need to write because you know what is a conductor. Now, see the second point. In electrostatics, specifically, all conductors are always equipotential surfaces. You know what is the meaning of equipotential surfaces? Sir, at the surface, potential is always equal at all points. What is the meaning of equal? Potential means potential. So, what is the meaning of equipotential surface? A surface which has the same potential at all points is called as equipotential surface. So, for example, I take one diagram like this. And I tell you, this is an equipotential surface where this one block has a potential of 2 volt. That means every block will have a potential of 2 volts. Equipotential. Understand? Equipotential surface. For example, if I say everyone in the class got equal marks, what does it mean? If one person got, say, 75, can I say any random student, if I pick up that person also has got 75? Because I have made a statement that everyone has got equal marks. So, very important, it's an assumption. Okay, it's an assumption. Therefore, I want you to write this as a point. In electrostatics, all conductors are always taken to be, or all conductors are assumed to have an equipotential surface. Write down point number one. Actually, it's point number two in your module, but you write it as your point number one. In electrostatics, conductors are always equipotential surfaces. Now look at the third point. Charge always resides on the surface of a conductor, means charge does not go inside. That is why charge is a surface property. Have you heard of this statement? Charge is a surface property, means charge does not penetrate inside. So write this third point as your second point. Charge always resides on the outer surface of the conductor. Right now. Charge always resides on the outer surface of conductor. Now, look at point number 5. Tell me if you have understood point number 5. Electric field is always perpendicular to conducting surface. Write that as your point number 3. Electric field is always perpendicular to conducting surface. How many points have you written? 3, correct? Now, look at point number 6. Look at point number 6. Electric, everyone switch on your cam, quick. Everyone switch on your cam. Point number 6. Electric lines of force never enter into conductor. Stop, don't write this. Can I say this? You have already written as a part of electric lines of force. As a first topic today that we have done, in that topic you have already written that electric lines of force.
Sir, can you repeat the second point?
Point number 2 is your first point. Point number 3 is your second point. Point number 5 is your third point.
Okay, sir.
Point number 6, no need to write because you already know that electric lines of force never enter into conductor. Seventh point also, you know, the general formula for electric field intensity for any random surface is given by sigma by epsilon naught. Point number 8 and point number 9 are very, very important. Look at point number 8. Point number 8 says that when a conductor is grounded, that means it is earthed. You know what is the meaning of grounding? Earthing. The potential becomes zero. And point number 9 is when an isolated conductor is grounded, then the charge also becomes zero. So write down point number 8 as your point number 4 and point number 9 as your point number 5. Point number 8 as your point number 4 and point number 9 as your point number 5. Look at point number 11. Look at point number 11. Electric pressure at the surface of the conductor is given by the formula. They have directly given the formula, no derivation. And this is not there in your 12th standard. This is something only for your JEE. Electric pressure at the surface of the conductor is given by sigma square by 2 epsilon naught, where sigma is the surface charge density. So make a note of this formula as your new formula. What is the formula for electric pressure? And the unit of pressure will be what? Force upon area, that is Newton upon meter square or Pascal. Electric pressure at the surface of the conductor is given by the formula P is equal to sigma square by 2 epsilon naught. Electric pressure at the surface of the conductor is given as P is equal to sigma square divided by 2 epsilon naught. Logical meaning of electrical pressure. Now, electrical pressure is given, I'll tell you. You 1 minute, let me see the whole thing. What is the logical meaning of electrical pressure is? See, when there are many electric lines of force passing on a surface, or there are a lot of potential passing through a surface, the surface also comes under a lot of force, correct? Because what is the unit of epsilon naught? What is the unit of electric lines of force? Check what is the unit of flux. You have written, right? Does Newton come in the formula for flux? Just check.
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
That force, if it acts on some area of that sphere, for example, can I say that force which acts on that particular area of that sphere, that becomes pressure, because pressure is nothing but force upon area. That is the meaning of electric pressure. Understood? Devan, should you understand the meaning? Got it?
Yes.
Okay. Now, come to the next page, page number 62. There is something, hence charge appearing on different surfaces as follows. Can you see that line on page number 62? Hence, charge appearing on different surfaces are as follows.
Yes, sir.
Phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4. Just put a box to that. When a problem comes, I will tell you how do you need to apply this logic to that problem. Okay. We are going to do problems later on. And when the problem of this type comes, you will need this formula or you will need the logic. So you will have to come back to page 62. So put a box to this whole thing. Hence, charge appearing on different surfaces are as follows. And then put a box to this. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Concept application exercise 4. Concept application exercise 4 onwards, we will do in the next class. Concept application exercise 4 onwards, we will do in the next class.
Okay,
the next class is Thursday, 7:30. Just tell me if it's right or wrong. If you have your time.
Yes, sir.
Thursday, 7:30 to 9:30. So whatever I do in today's class, Thursday's class, and I'll take one more class, I'll tell you when. So you'll have three classes to complete. That three, plus your 11th standard electrostatics is your syllabus for your Sunday's exam. Coming Sunday's exam. Whatever I do this week, plus 11th standard electrostatics is your syllabus for Sunday's exam. Is it clear?
Yes.
So I will see you on Thursday. I think Thursday I can take till 9:30. My 9 o'clock class we get over there, and we'll take a 2-hour session. We'll start from concept application exercise from there. Okay. So thank you all of you. I will see you on Thursday. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye, sir.
Cheers, sir.
Bye, sir. Bye, sir.